First, I am Dr. Kathleen Hicks. I am the co-lead with Heather Connolly. I direct the International Security Program, and so we on the defense and security side have partnered with our European program colleagues here to bring together this report on U.S. forces in Europe, focused on U.S. Army forces in Europe. And there is no better person to help us think through the challenges moving from Deputy Secretary Blinken's broad frame about the importance of alliances coming straight into the European theater and thinking about the security implications than General Phil Breedlove, just recently retired from being Supreme Allied Commander for Europe. Previously having served for the Air Component Command, as the Air Component Commander for both Europe and for Africa, also previously having served as the Vice Chief of Staff for the Air Force. What we're going to do here is have General Breedlove come up and give some opening remarks. We do promise to save time for Q&A after that. He and I will sit down and do a little Q&A with you. And then we're going to bring up, or we're going to let him get off the stage and bring up a few other analysts that I'll introduce at the time to talk more specifically about their recommendations from our study and how to just be thinking about U.S. Army forces in Europe going forward. So without further ado, please join me in welcoming General Breedlove.
Well, the most important thing that's going to happen here is not my brief remarks. I'll try to really quickly get to Q&A. The folks who have organized this have asked me to speak to just a couple of quick issues to sort of start the conversation. And so I have just a few thoughts that I will put out there, but we'll rapidly get to your questions. I'd like to echo the Secretary's remarks about standing in solidarity with our brothers and sisters in Turkey, our great ally, and the fact that they have been under a horrible attack. We hope to come to quick resolution on the things that are causing that kind of problem in Turkey. So first, the thought of Wales to Warsaw. Where are we? Good news is that the work that was assigned to the NATO alliance at Wales is largely done, and some of that work has actually been exercised and tested. Some of the creation of entities, the assigning of a mission, the multinational core northeast, standing up a VJTF that has been tested, standing up the NATO force integration units, or as we like to call them, NIFUs, beginning the work to stand up multinational division southeast to think more about the problems in the south. Much of that work is completely done, but what we need now, and we'll talk a little bit more about it in a minute, is continued commitment to meeting the requirements of that work, to making sure that the forces that we've agreed to increase their readiness and capability, remain fully supplied and ready for their mission. So, it's important also that these force contributions that are required to meet these obligations remain constant, steady, and I think even public and vocal. The fact that we are committed to the decisions of Wales and that we will see them through as they are just really beginning to their full intent as given to us by our leadership. And then I think also one of the most important things that has happened between Wales as we move towards Warsaw is that we as an alliance have come to grips with the issues of our NATO nations in the south. And how do we address that? And force structure, what does it mean? And we've actually put several operations into effect, including the operation in the Aegean Sea. And so it's important that NATO continues to remember that we have issues to the north and east and to the south, and that they are both incredibly important to our alliance in their own way. A few words on shifting from reassurance to deterrence. Much like the Secretary, I won't put words in the mouth of our leaders as they come together in the summit, but many expect that this will be one of the major conversations and could be one of the directions coming out of the summit, and that is, what does it look like to shift from reassurance to deterrence? What does it take? I have often said, when people said, we're on the road to Warsaw, I've often said, we're on the road through Warsaw. Warsaw will just be the next step in the adaptation of this alliance. There will need to be more beyond it. Deterrence is not the next step. It is a step on the journey, and deterrence will be enhanced as that journey goes along. It could be one of the biggest deliverables at Warsaw. And I think there will be an interesting conversation about what does deterrence mean in the South? How do you deter the kind of issues that our alliance faces in the South? A short note on the requirements for credible deterrence, since we're on that subject, and how that would work in sort of our current world situation. I'd like to make two keys. Everyone wants to talk about force structure, and clearly this conversation today and this report is about force structure, but I'd like to talk about two things that are sort of related, but I think they're as important and they're key up front. First of all, NATO already has a force structure. The question we have to ask ourselves is, what is the readiness of the existing force structure? I think one of the greatest keys to deterrence, what would really deter those who would seek to bring pressure on our alliance, is that our entire alliance, the force structure that we already have, becomes more ready and more responsive. And some of you probably are asking, what's the difference between the two? I do see a difference. We set forces to be ready on a certain time scale. We say a force is ready at 30 days, ready at 45 days, ready at 4 days. But what we also should do is look at how we make it ready and then also decrease the responsiveness, because a ready and responsive force is a great deterrent. So first and foremost, I like to talk about this force that we have and how we make that force more ready and responsive. And second, one of the greatest privileges I had in my military career was sitting at the last summit in Wales and watching the 28 leaders of our nations come to the decisions that they came to. And I was particularly pleased that one of the first and most demonstrative decisions they took was that there was a strong commitment to alliance Article 5 responsibilities and to the unity of the alliance. And I think that that's the second thing that we need to talk about right now. Not only raising the responsiveness and readiness of the entire force, but it is important, especially in the face of some of the political things that have happened in the last week or two, that we come to Warsaw and through Warsaw with a continued strong commitment to the unity of the alliance and to our absolute commitment to our Article 5 requirements. So now, a little bit more to the things that we want to talk about, and I'll leave the specifics to the questions and answers. But you have heard me talk when I was in uniform and post-uniform about our forward forces. I do not believe them to be adequate. What is the constitution of how we address that inadequacy? Is it more permanently stationed forces? Is it forces that might move further east in the alliance space? Is it prepositioned forces that we could rapidly fall in on? And this is the real art and science of what has to be done across the next few months and years. How do we as an alliance look at a force structure that deters, that we can afford and sustain, and how can we make it responsive to the speed of the challenge that we need? And I used a personal pronoun there that is important. We. The United States, I think, has to lead, but it cannot just be the United States involved in this. Our most important allies need to be along our side. I believe as we look at the force structure that we need to deter and to meet the challenge in Europe. We need to give a special emphasis to the enablers and to the firepower. We have, as I mentioned before, a large NATO force, and much of that force is that ground infantry, mechanized infantry, and to a limited degree, armored force. But what we don't have great depth in NATO are those exquisite enablers that brings precision and speed to our firepower. And so I think we should give an important close look at those. I also believe, and NATO has actually taken some firm steps in this endeavor, that we need to better train, exercise, and develop rapid political decision making. The ability to get in front of a threat is incredibly important, and it's hard enough in a military sense. We need to not also be slowed down in a political sense. And we've seen just recently, some pretty good exercises at the NAC and ambassadorial level to understand this. And then finally, another piece of that deterrence is I believe that we need to continue to refine the plans that prepare us. Just planning in detail is a strong message. But for military men and women, planning is essential. It's what we do to be prepared. And so I think that our plans need to move to the next level. Finally, I was asked to tie in A2AD, Anti-Access Area Denial, and talk just a tiny bit about what are the capabilities that I would see to be needed by the U.S. and the U.S. NATO team. I think first and foremost, a strategy and a policy decision is needed, i.e., do we create our own anti-access area denial capability? That is a big decision. It is decidedly an offensive feeling thing. I would subscribe that the capability that is sitting in Kaliningrad or the capability that is sitting in Crimea is decidedly offensive. It imposes cost on those in the area. And so first, in the realm of A2AD, I think we need to take a look at this from a policy sense as a nation and as an alliance, to say, is this a place that we should be making our moves? Should we be imposing cost and inconvenience and trouble to planners by having that capability? Now, as to how we address anti-access area denial, I would subscribe that we have the tools, but we do not have nearly enough of them. And the speed that we would need to eliminate these A2AD bubbles to be able to deploy our forces is going to be controlled by the depth of the bench of how we can attack those A2AD forces. And so I think that in general, we have the tools we need, but we don't have enough of them. And the next point I would make, which I think is germane to the discussion primarily of land forces, is that right now we are almost completely dependent on air forces and aviation assets in order to attack the A2AD problem. I submit my opinion that we need more long-range, survivable precision strike capability from the ground. We need dense capabilities, like the dense A2AD networks that we face. Should we be considering a long-range strike complex, which you've heard several senior leaders in DoD talking about? And then finally, I would say that one of the things that challenged me a lot as SACUR, we came out of 13 years of incredible work as an alliance in Afghanistan, really refining the kill chain as it relates to counterinsurgency warfare. But what we have lost over that time is the ability to do it at scale to support a large conventional effort. Do we have the targeteers that we need? Do we have the precision capability to precisely locate targets and transmit them quickly to the cockpit or to the ship of the shooter or to the long-range strike complex on the ground? We have some work to do in order to fully enable an at-scale conventional precision capability. We do it extremely well in a more limited, smaller counterinsurgency way. And so I think there is work to do in facing this A2AD challenge, in resolving NATO intelligence issues and building the capacity to do what we know we can do exquisitely in a smaller way. So I seriously shortened my notes to get to your questions, and I'm ready to do that now.
Thank you very much, and I will limit myself as well in the Q&A, although there's a very rich discussion to be had here, but just to make sure that folks have a chance to interact. Let me ask a really broad question. You having been SACUR, and obviously, as Tony Blinken pointed out, 39 plus years in the Air Force, coming up through a military structure and command of military forces, you're looking at a challenge set posed by Russia that crosses over, right, from A2AD at the high end, conventional military challenges. Of course, we didn't even discuss the nuclear challenges posed by Russia, into cyber, economic, political warfare, unconventional warfare, if you will, proxy forces, where military instruments traditionally have not had, a strong purpose. How should the alliance and its partners in the U.S. be thinking about a holistic approach? What should we be most concerned about and thinking about with regard to the Russia challenge set?
So I think, thanks for the question, because it's a very good one. And we have wrestled with this now for almost 2 years, the phenomena of the little green men in Crimea and what they were an expression of in this new war type of warfare. And the word was coined hybrid warfare. Although I was there when that was being coined, I'm not totally happy with that word because in effect, really, this form of warfare is old tools being used differently. But what we see in the difference in the way they're being used or expressed is that they are this new type of warfare, and I think Mr. Gerasimov calls it conflict by indirect means, is the words that my counterpart used. But the difference here is the breadth of the way this particular kind of conflict is carried on. I will use a very simple model that we were taught in war college. Simple things for simple minds. DIME, diplomatic, informational, military, and economic. DIME. And so this new form of warfare covers all of those instruments. In fact, in some nations, we see huge diplomatic, huge informational, huge economic in the form of energy warfare, and a very quiet military. It was a little different, of course, in Ukraine. Sure. We had broad pressure diplomatically to discredit Kyiv, an intense information campaign to attack the credibility of the institutions in Ukraine. And then, of course, a strong military effort, first in Crimea, second in the Donbas. And then finally, continually economic pressure in the form of speedy recall of loans, energy pricing, et cetera. Mm-hmm. So in Ukraine, you saw all of those elements. So I've built a big watch to say that we have come to understand that we have to be able to deal with this. Mm-hmm. And some of our nations are better prepared than others. And the point that we also have to understand, while this is more of a military discussion, that the tools used to address this larger scale of warfare are more in the MOI sometimes, the Ministry of Interiors, the policing forces, the judiciary, the legislative, than in the defense. And so we have to learn in those nations where we haven't had a long history of dealing with this kind of warfare, how to be able to meet this broad attack where we used to think more along the lines of the military. How do we join with our MOI or Interior Ministry type troops to be able to better bring both intelligence complexes together and not to be competing or possibly not sharing important information? And how do we create the capability to take a nation that feels it's under attack and be able to bring the aid of the alliance to that nation should it be warranted? We talked about a very simple framework: recognize, characterize, attribute. Recognize that you're under attack. Characterize it as not something normal. The last thing we would want to do is for NATO to get involved in an internal political legitimate movement in a nation. So recognize that there's an issue, characterize it as not normal and not a legitimate, and then finally attribute it to an aggressor. Because in the characterization and attributing, we have a parallel in the Article 4 and Article 5 process in order to be able to bring the instruments of the alliance to be able to be used. So we have, that's the wrong personal pronoun. They, I'm now out of that business, but when I was in that business, we started a process of working with the nations on these broad requirements of how you marry MOI, MOD to meet this challenge. And it's quite sporting because in some nations, it's almost all MOD with a small MOI piece. In some nations, it's more balanced. And in some nations, and I can name three of them, I won't, where it's almost entirely MOI or MOD and a little bit MOI. So each nation does it a little differently, and we need to meet them where they are and help them to develop the tools. So we're getting after that, and that is an important part of meeting this broader spectrum.
Yeah. Great. Okay, I am going to open it up, and when the mic comes to you, please give your name and affiliation. We have one over here. One question each, please.
Zach Biggs with Janes. I wanted to ask you specifically about cyber. At the Defense Ministerial earlier this month, cyber was declared an operational domain for NATO. There was also discussion about how Article 5 could be invoked specifically with a cyber attack. What does NATO need to do to be prepared for cyber now that it is an operational domain for the alliance? And thinking back to, for instance, the Estonia attack and what happened there, what do you think would happen this time if a similar attack occurred to a NATO member?
So NATO has already started the process of being better prepared to meet cyber attacks. As you know, we are 28 nations, and all 28 nations come to this problem in different places and different capabilities. And so for a long time, we were reticent to sort of share, but what we soon learned in NATO is that there are 28 doors into our alliance. And if there's one weak door, then the alliance will be under attack and could be compromised. And so some of the things that happened that were very important is we realize that this is something that we have to do collectively as well. Nations have their own Article 3, if you remember Article 3, their own requirement of their own defense. But then we have to look more collectively at defending against cyber. And so understanding where the weaknesses are and making a decision to better share among nations what we know has been an important part of starting. And now we are developing the bench and the rules, the hygiene, and all the things that we do as an alliance. And I would, by the way, commend to you the Cyber Center of Excellence. They are doing some really good work.
In Estonia.
Outstanding work there. And the range that they have put together in order to fight and practice is really quite demonstrative. So, and then I would just say the last piece, which is, it was after I left that these pronouncements were made, but I was watching them be formed. An important part of this is getting to that policy piece that we talked about in a few of my remarks. What are going to be the policies of how we go forward? There is a lot of angst about offensive cyber, but active defense requires some offensive actions. And so there are policy decisions that need to be taken, and I'll be watching them just like you will as the alliance goes forward on that.
Great. Okay, I had one right back here at the camera.
Thank you so much. My name is Ivo Puljic. I'm from Al Jazeera Balkans, bureau chief here, Washington, D.C.
Can you pull the mic?
Yeah, you mentioned a few times, and we heard the word Russia. What is your opinion about Russian role in southeast of Europe? Serbia is pretty much in love with Russia right now. Russia has big impact in one part of Bosnia. And just from those countries, Croatia is only member of NATO. And what do you think about Montenegro and what Montenegro can bring to NATO with future membership? Thank you so much.
Okay, so that's technically two questions, so you get to pick
Yeah,
one.
There were actually two or three questions in there.
You get to pick one.
I think I did never mention Russia in my remarks. I kept talking about possible adversaries. Russia, of course, have been brought up in the rest of your remarks, and of course, Russia has been a great concern. You have heard me in recent speeches talk about Russia pulling back that hand of cooperation and changing the paradigm under which we have been operating, and the fact that they have used force to change internationally recognized borders is a great issue for our alliance, the EU, the entire world to deal with. But what I think we do need to do, and I said this recently as well, is we need to continue to take the actions that we have taken at Wales. We need to implement the actions that the directions that will be given at Warsaw. We need to continue to make our alliance militarily credible, more ready, more responsive, and deal from a position of a strong, united, defensive alliance with a Russia that I believe in the future we need to have some kind of relationship with. How do you describe that relationship? Is it partnership? Is it mutual respect? What is it that would allow Russia and Europe to cooperate in economic spheres and other things, which I think would prosper all? But that has to be done, again, from a position of a strong, united, defensive alliance, and it has to be done on a basis of good behavior of all of the partners in the agreement. Montenegro says the door is open, and it also is a very strategic place. Can you imagine an A2AD bubble in Montenegro?
Great. Okay, a couple more. We have one right here.
Thank you. Maya Kay, Voice of America, Georgian Service. In the wake of Brexit, Admiral Stavridis wrote in Foreign Policy that it might not be the challenge, quite the contrary for the NATO, what is lost for EU might be the gain for the NATO, meaning that Great Britain will have more military resources to put in place for the alliance. Do you think this is the case, and how do you perceive how NATO should be addressing this challenge, if it is a challenge? Thank you.
So I would never venture to grade Jim Stavridis's paper. So I'll sort of dodge that part of it. I think I've been asked this question several times. What is your concerns with Brexit? And I always do the same thing. I'm not going to make any geopolitical statement. I'm probably not qualified to do that. What I think I am qualified to do is remark on how it might affect NATO. And frankly, I don't see a huge impact to NATO. The UK is an incredibly important, vibrant, active part, a full spectrum partner in NATO, and I don't see that changing. If anything, this, I think, will engender a conversation along the lines of what I talked about in my opening remarks, and that is, I believe one of the most important things that happened in Wales was that upfront, early, vocal, strong commitment to unity and Article 5. And I think that this will engender, again, a conversation about how important for NATO is our unity, our commitment, and Article 5.
Great. Okay, well, last question here, and then we'll switch over to the panel.
General Air Commodore Tenhoff, the Dutch Defense Attaché, thanks first of all for your words. My question is as follows. You stressed the need for recognition. You stressed the need for speedily decision making. In order to do so, you need good indicators, good warnings. Mm-hmm. In order to have a more integrated approach, I mean, I don't worry about the speedily intel processing within NATO, but with other organizations, for example, EU, we clearly could have an issue there. Could you share some thoughts on this part of the subject?
So I will disappoint those who have heard me talk about this before because my opinion has not changed from the last 4 years. And that is that while we have good intelligence organizations in NATO, we have a lot of work to do on intelligence in NATO. We have come through a period where we were making a partner of Russia, and we literally took our eyes off of the operational and tactical part of the Russian forces. We kept our eyes strategically on those very important things that posed existential threats to our nations. But by and large, most of our nations, and I say nations because it's more than just mine, intelligence apparatus over the past 10 to 15 years have shifted to those problems emanating from ungoverned spaces, unresponsive governments in the Middle East and in the area around Syria and Iraq. And so by and large, we have lost a focus that Captain Phil Breedlove saw when he first went to serve in NATO in the early 1980s. We had a laser focus back then on not only the strategic, but the operational and the tactical. And so I'm building a watch, I'm sorry, but it's important. It is important that we refocus enough. We'll never go back to where we were because our nations face incredible challenges from the South. But it is important that we refocus enough of our intelligence, both technical and non-technical, on the issue. And it's important that we better fuse it. I have been a bit critical of NATO in that we sort of are episodic in the way we share intelligence. When we're under threat, we share intelligence very well. When we don't feel under threat, we don't. And those peaks and valleys don't allow us to understand the norm. It is from understanding the norm that we can build indications and warnings. You are exactly right. We need a series of indications and warnings that allow us to get with credibility to the political decision makers and say, this is not normal, and it could mean this. We need to take early action to preclude rather than late action to deal with the consequences. And so I talked an awful lot, just to rehash, I think we need to refocus. It will never be what it used to be. We need to understand better the operational level and to some degree the tactical level of our opponent. We need to be able to better share that broadly and share it consistently so that we can understand a norm from which we can develop good indications and warnings that allow us, again, with credibility, to go to our political decision makers and say, we need to do something. And that is a lot of work. I do believe we are headed in that direction. But this will take sustained effort over time.
Well, I want to thank you, General Breedlove, for sharing your thoughts this morning and taking a little time to take questions. We're going to have you exit the stage, and we're going to invite up our panel of experts. Okay, so thank you all very much. We're going to spend some time here talking specifically about the report that we've put together regarding the future of the U.S. land component, U.S. Army Europe component of contributions to European security. But we'll, of course, put that within the joint context. Joining me today to my immediate left is Dr. Evelyn Farkas, former colleague from the Defense Department, former Deputy Assistant Secretary.
Former boss.
colleague sounds nicer. For Russia and Eurasia, and she is a non-resident fellow, a senior fellow, at the Atlantic Council. To her left is Lisa Samp, who is a senior fellow here in the International Security Program, and who has led the effort on behalf of the Europe and International Security Program teams to run this study for us. And to her left is...
Also a former colleague.
And to her left is Jeff Ratke, who is the deputy director and I believe senior fellow inside the Europe program here at CSIS and also was instrumental in running this program and a former State Department official. So what we're going to do is begin with Evelyn to talk a little bit, maybe in some ways along the lines of the question I just asked General Breedlove. What is your assessment of how the U.S. and its allies ought to be thinking about the Russia threat, and particularly if you're trying to think ahead to what the implications are for the land component?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think, I think it's helpful to step back and look at what Russia's objectives are. I mean, first of all, we should say just a word about the leadership, and I know you guys do cover it in your excellent report. But, you know, we should just assume that, you know, President Putin's going to be in power until 2024, that he'll win those 2018 elections. Even if that changes, we can probably assume that the trajectory in terms of the military modernization and the political objectives will stay the same for Russia. So having said that, a word about the objectives. For the Russian government, for this regime, the most important thing is staying in power, so maintaining their current system, which is autocratic, and not a free market economy. It's sort of a corrupt, mafia-style, you know, globalized economy. Their second objective is to demonstrate that Russia is a global power on par with the rest of, you know, the United States, et cetera. Third objective is to really rewrite the rules of the road so that you cannot have interventions to force regime change in cases even where you have a despotic ruler like Bashar al-Assad, who is, you know, murdering his people. And then, you know, sort of related to that are these other objectives. They want to maintain territorial and economic control of their periphery, which is Eastern Europe and Central Asia. And then also, now I'm forgetting what my last one was. If possible, break NATO and the EU, so the transatlantic unity. And that, of course, does get to land forces, et cetera, because I do think it's important that it isn't just us, as General Breedlove said, but that we have allies involved also contributing significant forces. So having said that about the objectives, I think it might be helpful for me to say a few words about their modernization.
Sure.
Because it's not as if they're modernizing across the board.
Right.
And it sounds like a lot, $700 billion, but of course, as you know, to us, that's not actually that much because it's over 10 years. But they're doing it in a very clever way. And so they're increasing their capabilities in certain key conventional areas, and I think it was mentioned earlier, you know, cruise missiles, the air defense systems, et cetera, which are causing quite a problem for us, obviously. Mm-hmm. But they're not doing everything across the board all at once. The other thing, of course, is this hybrid capability, which we saw it play out in real life in Ukraine first, certainly most successful in Crimea, because I would argue in eastern Ukraine it hasn't been a success for them. And then, of course, we're seeing it play out in Syria to some extent, although there it's a little bit different. But they have demonstrated to us also that they can deploy, Again, these aren't large-scale, huge deployments like we're used to, but they're nevertheless, they're out of area, certainly in the case of Syria. So I think that the modernization in and of itself does pose challenges, but then it's also the cyber component, the doctrinal changes. So mm-hmm. we haven't really talked that much about the doctrinal changes, but you know, number one, they now have the doctrine that allows them to respond with nuclear force to mm-hmm. a conventional attack that they deem a threat to the existence of the state. And that's a new and disturbing development, probably mostly because this government, this regime, especially since 2012 when Putin came back into office, has really been rattling the nuclear saber. Mm-hmm. So I think we're a little bit nervous about what they would deem a threat to the state.
Right.
Then there's also
and
the...
I would just ask, in particular, Kaliningrad is situated as it is in the midst, if you will, of NATO territory, would be a place where one could see some kind of miscalculation or something that might, you know, bring into question, I would think, that nuclear
potentially,
question.
Potentially, yeah. Although, hopefully, they still define it a little more narrowly, mm-hmm. you know, their command, the Moscow, et cetera, but... Mm-hmm. One doesn't know because they are purposely a little bit vague mm-hmm. on this,
yes.
right? The other issue is the escalate to de-escalate, which has been interpreted by some to actually be about nuclear weapons and tactical nuclear weapon use, but it's actually not that. It's denying your adversary the ability to get in, to intervene in an mm-hmm. ongoing or an imminent military action that the Russian government wants to take. So they can use cyber means, they can use space, you know, they can do anything to basically escalate the situation to a point where the United States or other European allies might say, oh, we'll keep out of that. You know,
yeah,
that's
it's not
Russia's
worth
problem.
Our interest.
Right, it's
yeah.
not worth it. Mm-hmm. So that's all, you know, kind of Sun Tzu-ish, you know, mm-hmm. Philosophy. But it could involve a nuclear demonstration or nuclear use, potentially, but it's not necessarily, I don't see it as necessarily being about nuclear. So I think those are important things when we think about how are we going to deal with Russia. Those are potential... real challenges that we face because of their doctrine. And then, of course, as was mentioned earlier, the hybrid warfare. And I think there it's really difficult because you have to work law enforcement, military, political actors, because you have to first obviously have the intelligence, then you have to be able to share the intelligence. And you know, we think it's hard among countries. It's also hard, as we found out in our own experience here before 9/11, or with 9/11, that it's also hard to share intelligence domestically. So all of our NATO allies and, of course, the partners, because we have a certain responsibility, it's not an Article 5 responsibility, but certainly to help our partners, they all have to be able to have good intelligence and to share this intelligence and to act on it. And then the act on it part is where the other agencies, like entities like EU and others, come into play. So that's kind of a long answer, and I don't know whether I've come right to your point. I mean, I think in terms of land forces, you need agility. You need intelligence so that you know where to go. You need to be agile. And again, as I mentioned, I think you have to have multiple allies involved. You know, mm-hmm. we all have a role to play.
Yeah.
And that's the most important thing. But I would also say that I agree with, I don't know whether General Breedlove talked about the rotational versus permanent, but I would say I'm one of the signatories of the Atlantic Council's report that just came out mm-hmm. this week on the future of
yes.
NATO. And am I allowed to mention another
sure.
thing?
Sure, you absolutely are. I already mentioned it.
Anyway, and in there we call for permanent forces. So
yes.
I think land forces, they need to be permanent. You can't expect that a rotation is going to be smooth, seamless. That the equipment will be there and ready, and I think the readiness issue is a big one as well. And I think it's also worth noting that what we're talking about right now within the alliance is simply putting back into place what we had just a few years ago. So we're not even talking about doing more, which and doing more may not be the answer. I'm not suggesting that, because again, if you want to be agile, that may not be the
answer.
You mean
more in terms of size
beyond the
of
two
the
brigades.
Footprint. Yes,
yeah, so
got
if
it.
We put the two, let's say we put the two brigades back mm-hmm. permanently, there's an open question about whether that's enough mm-hmm. or not, but I think certainly for at least the signatories of this report and myself,
yes.
getting the two back permanently would be important.
Okay. That's a perfect segue to Lisa and where we come out in
is.
Our report,
indeed.
Which is a little bit different, not different hugely
not
in intent,
different,
but
it
would be
yeah.
great to have you sort of talk a little bit about how we, in our report, have sort of approached this challenge across the looking at Europe in whole, and how we look in particular at the challenges from the East.
Well, thank you. And Evelyn did a great job setting this up because she perfectly described the Russia challenge that actually prompted U.S. Army Europe to ask us for our thoughts on how we can recalibrate U.S. Army presence in Europe over the long term. And I'm going to mention three quick key points, but first I just want to say a few words about how we conducted the study itself. So we did it in two phases. The first phase looked short term, so you know, what are the low-hanging fruit type of recommendations that could help inform the Army's FY17 budget request. We were very pleased that a lot of those recommendations ended up coinciding with the FY17 ERI request. But this second phase of the study that we're rolling out today looks long-term, so over the next 10 years, and places a greater emphasis on making the Army presence in Europe not only credible against the Russia threat, but also affordable, as General Breedlove mentioned, and sustainable long-term. And two quick caveats that I would be remiss if I didn't mention. The first is that our report does not make recommendations related to waging an active defense of the Baltic states. What we are trying to do is set up a credible deterrent, something that will change Russia's calculus enough that it would choose not to intervene, or that would it would assess the cost of that intervention to be inordinately high. That's the first caveat. The second is that, of course, while we focus on ground forces, the whole force is going to be important in this. So the Air Force, the Marines, the Navy, allied militaries, and of course, whole of governments across the dime, when she mentions there. So with those two caveats, I'll move quickly through my three key points. The first is that the capability gap with Russia is real, but as we looked at it, it is regionally bound. So I want to be clear that the Russian military is not a Goliath that cannot outmatch the United States across global battlefields. It does, however, possess advanced capabilities that is currently arrayed, could plausibly challenge the United States and its allies regionally, or rather in one region, and that is Central and Eastern Europe. So that's kind of the first point. There are three key capability areas where we assess Russia has or is gaining an advantage. The first, sir, you spoke to is A2AD. The second is combined arms warfare, which I think you also mentioned, and then, of course, the non-kinetic, which is cyber and electronic warfare. So, of course, these capabilities will need to be factored into future Army planning priorities or procurement priorities as well. And our report goes into greater detail on these issues, but I will save you all from that discussion as they get very technical very quickly, and I think we've kind of covered the high points. So my second point, then, is that the current U.S. approach to reinforcing Europe is not cost-efficient long-term. So since 2014, the Obama administration has spent approximately $1.8 billion on assurance efforts, with a further $3.4 billion in the pipeline for 2017. So what this has done is reverse the downward trend in the force size, U.S. force size on the continent, which is a great thing, of course. And was achieved sensibly at the time by relying on surging rotational forces from the United States back to Europe. Now that we have our bearings, we know a little bit more about what Russia's intention is, the role that they want to play in the world, we need a new model, a longer-term model for responding. So just as the Warsaw Summit will mark a shift from assurance to deterrence to longer-term deterrence, the United States also needs to begin shifting from this sort of surge mentality to a longer-term sort of new normal footing or force posture in Europe. The immediate post-Ukraine Band-Aid solution is no longer the most optimal solution, and it's about to get a lot more expensive. Next year's proposed budget in the FY17 ERI vastly expands the cost of using the rotational forces. This is because the forces that are currently doing the rotations are able to rely on pre-positioned equipment in Eastern Europe. Beginning in February, they will no longer have that pre-positioned equipment in Eastern Europe, so they will be bringing their own equipment with them from the United States to Eastern Europe. This will entail shuttling thousands of pieces of equipment from, you know, across the Atlantic every 9 months. It includes a brigade's worth of tanks and other heavy vehicles, upwards of 2,000 vehicles, in fact, and 12,000 other pieces of equipment. So as I said, this is not going to be cheap. And given the enduring requirement for armored forces in Europe, permanently stationing an armored brigade back in Europe, while it may entail higher upfront costs, would be more cost efficient over the long term. And it would, as Evelyn mentioned, partially reverse the decision, the department's 2012 decision to remove the two armored BCTs from Europe. So that would get us one up. In the same vein, we also recommend that a full-strength combat aviation brigade be reassigned to Europe on a permanent basis. The downsizing of the 12th Cab in Germany in the last couple years was another controversial and, frankly, oddly timed decision, given what was going on in the security environment in Europe at the time. So with that decision, combat army aviation shrank from about 170 helicopters, we're now down to 78. Like armored forces, the army aviation is an enduring requirement. The rotational backfill of 25 Blackhawks has high transportation costs attached to it, approximately $40 million in next year's ERI, and even then it's still insufficient to meet current demands. And then on to my third and final point, which is that the current approach is not sustainable long-term, so not cost-effective and not sustainable. So cost aside, the volume and pace of training events and continuous deployments to NATO's eastern flank are beginning to strain some U.S. and Baltic forces. This means that if we don't add additional forces to better distribute the burden, and if everything else stays the same, the current model is not ideal. In the Baltics, the size and capacity of the militaries there is often underappreciated. The Estonian and Latvian militaries, for example, combined to total about 11,000 forces. This is about a quarter of the daily population of the Pentagon. So let that
that's
sink
just
in.
The Starbucks line.
And that's
probably
just the Starbucks line, exactly. So their small size makes it difficult for host nations to keep up with the fresh U.S. and other allied troops that are persistently cycling through and to comfortably absorb them when they're there. Sir, you mentioned the NIFUs. Here lies a potential solution. You know, they could do a better job of coordinating, deconflicting, acting as a clearinghouse for allied forces that are cycling through. On our study trip, we spoke to some representatives from the NIFUs, and our anecdotal evidence suggests that they're not yet prepared to play this role. It doesn't mean they won't get there, but they're not yet doing it. This is partially due to the fact that allied forces rotating through are not yet required to notify the local NIFU that they're in town. And some of the folks we spoke to, cited that they were running into their local war buddies at the gas station and figuring out, oh, that the Dutch are in town, or that
right.
the, and they were referring to this as personality-driven awareness. So they were out there sort of on the beat looking for folks. Likewise, U.S. soldiers conducting the assurance mission in Europe are reaching their saturation point. The changing nature and heightened pace of military engagements, along with extended rotations, have replaced the 1 to 2 week security cooperation engagements that were typical prior to the Ukraine crisis.
Mm-hmm.
This has introduced, in the words of one soldier we spoke with, all the trials of deployment with none of the rear support. What he meant by this is that, one, they're stretched really thin, but that, two, unlike other enduring or named operations, these troops do not yet receive deployment benefits that make a persistent rotational presence sustainable for them and their families over the long term. These include things like eligibility for free additional child care at the on-base daycare center. U.S. troops transiting through the Baltics also do not yet enjoy SOFA protections. Status of forces agreements, legal agreements, protections. And this may have been a non-issue pre-Ukraine, but now that we have upwards of 5,000 U.S. troops cycling through this region per year, it amounts to, in the words of one official we spoke with, living on borrowed time. And it's an easily mitigated risk that we just need to take care of.
Is that covered by NATO SOFA?
They have a NATO SOFA. They don't have a U.S. SOFA. so these are the additional protections that when you have a Russia that is trying to make media hay out of every little incident and also very legalistic societies, the additional SOFA protections provided by the United States are needed. We make many other recommendations in this study. Unfortunately, that's all I have time for, and right. I know Jeff's going to talk to the eastern flank.
Right, yeah. So, Jeff, it would be great to kind of narrow in even further. The folks at the pointy end of the spear are on the eastern flank facing Russia, and it would be great to hear from you some of the recommendations that are specifically targeted to how we shore up that part of the alliance.
Great. Thanks, Kath, and it's an honor to be on this panel and indeed with such distinguished guests here today. I will say two general remarks and then get into four specific recommendations in our report with regard to the presence in the east of U.S. Army forces. The first one, and this is implicit in what Lisa said, but what we're talking about in this report are recommendations over a 10-year period. So these are not recommendations for the NATO summit, although there is broad overlap in some respects, but what we're looking at is what is necessary over the span of a decade to deal with the challenge that Evelyn so ably outlined. The second thing I would mention is, you know, while we're focused on U.S. Army forces and therefore on the land component, you know, we recognize that there are significant challenges in the southeast, in particular those that confront Romania and Bulgaria, which are more of a maritime and air nature. Those require also significant attention from NATO, but they don't fit with the land forces focus of our study. So let me now move on to four particular recommendations. One is about the nature of the forward presence that we recommend. The second is to address the question of permanent versus rotational forces, where we come out slightly differently than the Atlantic Council report. Third is the role of NATO and of our allies in the forward deterrent presence. And then the last is a bundle of issues, the civilian-military interaction, which General Breedlove alluded to, also civilian U.S. engagement in building resilience, which is an essential element of deterrence. So with that, forward presence, the first element. We are clear that a reinforcement-only strategy is not sufficient. There needs to be a forward presence of U.S. Forces. Our recommendation is for the continuous forward presence of one U.S. battalion each in Estonia, Latvia, and Lithuania. Now, why a battalion? In our view, that is the appropriate size because, on the one hand, it can command and control multiple maneuver units over a large enough territory that any kind of incursion or invasion by Russia, in this case, would not be able to avoid contact with U.S. forces. And if Russian decision makers know they have to face combat-capable U.S. and NATO forces, then that, we believe, will have a significant effect on Russia's risk calculation. So, in short, it's to put a credible deterrent at the location of greatest threat. One footnote, perhaps. Certainly, our Russian colleagues will call this provocative. In fact, they already are calling NATO's activity in Central and in Eastern Europe provocative. I think by any measure, the presence of a battalion-sized U.S. force is not going to invade Russia. It is not a military threat to Russia. I think it is important to keep that in mind, while also acknowledging, as General Breedlove pointed out, the importance of the communication channel so that we are dealing not only in political signals in communiques, but also in directly explaining motivation and the nature of our future presence. So the second item I'll touch on is the permanent versus rotational question. Our recommendation is for a rotational U.S. presence at battalion-sized forward operating sites. Now, why not permanent? Four elements were significant for us. First, permanent stationing involves significant infrastructure costs. Host nations may well be willing to bear most or even all of those costs, but do you want to crowd out investment by, in this case, our Baltic allies? Do we want to crowd out their investment in high priority capabilities and systems in favor of building facilities for U.S. forces? We think not. The second element is that the rotation, which will involve mostly infantry but also armored units, it allows variation over time, which also helps to build a broader spectrum of interoperability with our allies and partners. Third, we think it's possible to do this within the political constraints of the NATO-Russia Founding Act, which, for now at least, remain important for alliance political cohesion, which is something we can't overlook. And fourth, there is, of course, the principle of worldwide availability of U.S. forces, and in a true contingency, there needs to be the opportunity, the availability of those forces, and so having them in places where they are logistically better connected to likely contingency locations is important. The third issue, NATO and the role of our allies. It is essential that NATO's deterrent presence be a shared endeavor, not a U.S. responsibility only. Our recommendation is that the forward presence of one U.S. battalion each be part of a framework multinational brigade, which would include a battalion from that is led by another capable NATO ally and a host nation battalion. Four reasons for this. One, we think this has the best combination of multinationality and military efficiency by not breaking down units below the battalion level into multinational formations. Second, this builds alliance unity and sends a strong signal to Russia that an attack would involve not just host nation, but also major European and US forces. Third is the element of burden sharing. Under this approach, two-thirds of the forces involved in this forward presence would be non-US forces, although the US would play an important role strengthening and as a backbone. And fourth, this builds interoperability for possible high-intensity operations, which strengthens over time NATO's collective defense. Again, keeping in mind that we're thinking over a 10-year period here, not about meeting a challenge only of the coming year. The last item on which I'll be brief, and we can talk about it more in questions if necessary, is the idea of civilian and civil military resilience. Agree completely with General Breedlove's comments about the need to better develop relations between ministries of defense and ministries of the interior. These vary widely across NATO and especially along the eastern flank. Many nations have taken steps to exercise these interactions and to exercise civilian leadership and at the cabinet level, how they would respond in a crisis. That needs to be continued, and it also needs to be integrated into NATO's response as a whole so that those lessons are not lost and that NATO allies have confidence in what their allies on the eastern flank are going to do in response to a crisis. Now, a forward land presence is essential, but given Russia's approach to coercion and conflict, it is not likely to be the first element that is involved. So we need to build the civilian resiliency. There, in addition to the border security and defense, there is also the question of cyber. Not only the military aspects of cyber, but it is our view that the public-private partnerships, in particular critical infrastructure and private sector infrastructure, whether it be in finance or in other key sectors, needs to be further strengthened. There are gaps across NATO allies, and those need to be addressed. The last element I would mention is resources. The $3.4 billion request in the ERI for fiscal year 2017 is something we certainly agree with. On the civilian side, to be honest, the resources that are in the pipeline are meager in comparison. There is a large request for support to Ukraine, which is completely justified. But when you look at the six NATO countries along the eastern flank, none of them has a specific program of US civilian assistance proposed for fiscal year 2017. That means rule of law, that means media training, that means anti-corruption, it means border security, it means all of these things. And we think that there's more that needs to be done there, although specific recommendations fall outside the scope of our report. So with
that's
that,
great.
Thank you very much.
And I should have mentioned the report is now available online. It's at CSIS.org.
And there is an executive summary in case you're not interested in the full, I think, 70.
Why would you not be interested 80,
in it's
the
upwards
full.
Of 80 pages,
odd pages of the report.
It's a really short executive summary.
It's a 1.5 page executive.
There you go, right. Yeah, so truly for an executive. But if you love all things Army, please continue through the 80 pages. I just want to raise one thing that has come up throughout the day, but just to really pick on it, because I don't think we've come at it through this lens, which is the alliance cohesion piece. That is the clear center of gravity if you're Russia in terms of looking at the alliance. And I'd just love for each of you to give a quick comment on what you think is important, either in our own report or looking forward going into the Warsaw Summit. What are the key things about making sure we truly have, and then we have left others to perceive, cohesion in the alliance with regard to our defensive posture?
I two things come to mind. One is, again, this intelligence that General Breedlove mentioned, intelligence sharing, but the ability to see what's happening, and then for all the allies to agree on the intelligence. Mm-hmm. I think that's as somebody who witnessed, you know, our response to the situation in Ukraine, you know, one of the biggest vulnerabilities we faced was the ability to have political cohesion based on the intelligence. And so, and it is true that sometimes you don't want to see something that's in front of you, and that's another problem. But I do think for cohesion, it's important to have good intelligence that you can share in real time. The other part is resources. You know, I think that I'm going to say something that's boring because it's obvious. Everybody has to put in more into the pot. And, you know, it's funny because I had a hard time when I went into the executive branch with the 2%. And I was like, why do I keep thinking it's 3%? And I realized that, you know, I never really thought about it that much. And then the other day, Nick Burns, Ambassador Burns, reminded us, well, it used to be 3%. So please, let's not change it from 2% anything lower. And in fact, it probably should go up to 3%. And then it's not even about the percentage, of course. It's about what do you bring to the table.
What are the real capabilities?
And ideally, the GDPs will go up. So I think really resources and intelligence.
Right.
Please. And Evelyn stole mine because I was going to be the boring bureaucrat and say resources as well. You know, as much to the chagrin of many of our allies who sort of lament the American focus on this 2% spending, it actually is very important. It's very important for our Congress. It's very important for the American people to see everybody paying their share. And I will note that, as Evelyn alluded to, the 2% is not a ceiling. Mm-hmm. So if we can go beyond that, that's even better. So I will double hit resources. And then, of course, you know, showing a balance, I think, between the concerns of our eastern flank allies and our southern flank allies, showing that NATO is, you know, I think as Stoltenberg puts it, a 360-degree alliance, that it is all for one and one for all, and that we can walk and chew gum at the same time, I think is going to be increasingly important, as will, you know, foot stomping the idea of how NATO works with the EU. We have a multitude of challenges right now that are not solely military. We have terrorism and migration and, for lack of a better word, hybrid warfare that are all full spectrum sort of threats, not just hard security. So I think seeing how NATO will balance both of those priorities and threat perceptions from the allies will be important.
And can I add one other thing? I don't know if it's in your report, but on our resourcing, you know, this ERI or EDI, now it's going to be renamed, I think as a result of the new bill coming out of the Hill, the new authorization bill, but that money needs to be in the regular budget.
In the base
you and
budget.
I discussed this the other day. It needs to be in the base budget.
Yep.
Here, Jeff.
I'd say two things are important that they're related. One is confidence. I think it's in looking at ways in which NATO can improve its response, we often focus on gaps, and that's justified. But I think we need to avoid talking down NATO's capabilities,
right,
which are significant and effective. And so we need to keep that in mind. And that brings me to the second aspect of it, which is if you look at what has been decided since in the last 2 years, you have allies leading the placement of allied forces along the eastern flank of NATO at levels that I think would have surprised anyone if they had been mentioned in 2014. The level of political solidarity, it's not just the United States that's doing it, is significant, and we need to build on that and not downplay our achievements.
Great. Okay. Questions on?
I think.
Thank you. Oh yeah, please. Of course, John Breedlove.
It was sort of said, which is, it's not just the 2%; it's what you bring to the table. I never say 2% without the 20%, because
we have, you know, we have to be recapitalizing
the 20% being the investment fund.
Right.
The
so the 2% is the first measure. The 20% investment in recapitalization, investment, research and development. Is it has to really be tied together.
Mm-hmm. Great.
Absolutely.
Any questions? Fantastic. Our report is that convincing, we assure you. I want to thank all our guests today, obviously Deputy Secretary Blinken, my co-lead, Heather Connolly, all our panelists here today, General Breedlove. And thank you to all of you who came. I do hope you check out the report, and I look forward to hopefully a great Warsaw Summit.
Great. Right.